Hello, church family. I want to talk to you today about true salvation. Listen to Isaiah 55:6. It says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near." I can't hardly even read that passage without thinking back to when I was a little boy and we used to play hide and go seek. My dad used to hide me in some of the most amazing places. He would take the pillows off the bed and he would lay me. I was so thin and so small back then. He would lay me down where the pillows were, and he would take blankets and make them look like pillows and everything, and then put the cover back over me. And my brother and sisters would look for me for a long time until I got frustrated being under there. They couldn't find me. Well, I remember one time my dad had this great idea to take off the front of the piano and put me in the piano. And I was in there for like 45 minutes until I finally said, "Okay, I don't want this game anymore." But if God wanted to hide from us, he could hide from us forever without us finding him. But that's not his desire at all. His desire is for us to seek him. He says, "You will seek for me and find me when you seek for me with all your heart." Eric Gilmore, I talked about him last week. I'm just going to spend a lot of time this week on quotes out of his book called Union. And he says this, he says, "To not seek him," speaking of God, "is to seek something else." We're always seeking something. It's not like if we're not seeking God, we're not seeking someone or something else. We're always seeking someone or something. Seeking the Lord is the perpetual drawing near to him, is what he says. It is this constant motion that we are constantly and consistently drawing near, trying to come after him all the time. It's not this haphazard thing. The one thing that we have to believe about God, that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God wants you to run after him the way he deserves. And he hides himself so you don't accidentally stumble up on him. His holiness automatically hides him from just a gaze of someone that's not really pursuing him. But the moment we put the pursuit of him above everything else, he says, "You will find me when you are seeking me like that." Jesus says, "Come unto me and I will give you rest." The tense of that phrase, listen to this, implies a continual coming. So he's basically saying, keep on coming unto me. The life of rest is a life of endless coming to Jesus, Eric says. So if you're going to enter into this rest, it's not a rest of not coming towards him and not pursuing him. It's actually, that's where you find your rest, as you're continually and endlessly coming unto Jesus. No matter what the circumstance or what the situation, we go to him. It is his constant presence, which is our only salvation. It is Christ in you, the Bible says, the hope of glory. Do you realize that God connects his presence and salvation together right there? He says, if Christ isn't in you, if his presence isn't with you and in you, then you don't have hope of glory. But if he's in you and you truly are experiencing, I know theologically, you know, we talk about this and everybody understands this, that Christ must come into you. And that's what salvation is. But I really want to honestly, in our lives, in my life and in your life, do you experience God's sweet, glorious, intimate presence on a daily basis? That's what God is desiring for us every single day. To live outside of the light of his presence is to live in a dungeon of darkness. The Bible says the wicked, they stumble and they don't even know what caused them to stumble, because they're living in darkness. They're outside of this presence of God, this intimate fellowship with him moment by moment. He says, if you walk in the light as he is in the light, right? It says the blood of Christ cleanses you from all iniquity. You have fellowship with him and with others. That's what God desires. But without the light of his presence, we will be barren. We will be in this prison, this dungeon of darkness, and we will be barren. I remember having a man come over who had become very wealthy through farming, and he had written books on it, and at least a book on it and things. And I had him come over to my house because we were wanting as a family to start a garden. And so I just wanted to pick his brain and have some advice from him. And the first thing I'll never forget, he came to our property and was looking at where the shade shade was and where the sun was. And he picked us a spot where he said, this is the best spot for your garden, basically, because of how much sun it's going to get throughout the day. Without being fruitful, God tells us one day we're going to be cut off. It's about bearing fruit. And bearing fruit from this gardener, he knew instantly he had to find a place that this garden was going to get access to the right amount of sun so that it could produce a crop. So it's really wild. I just want to talk to you for a moment. Are you living in the light of his presence? It's the light of his presence that makes you grow and will ultimately make you fruitful. You know, there's a flower called the sunflower, and it's really wild. It's called that because as it comes up, it faces the east. As the sun is coming up, its big flower faces the sun constantly and consistently. It never looks away. It never gets distracted. It's always facing the sun. And as the sun starts moving towards the west, it also will move throughout the day. So it is constantly in the presence and absorbing that sun. And it is huge. It never stops growing because it is always facing the sun. And it bears lots of seed. And I'm telling you, the key to us being fruitful in God's kingdom is to always have the light of his presence within us. You know, there's a little story of a little Catholic girl who was fascinated with the massive stained glass windows in this cathedral. And they were all pictures of, you know, what the Roman Catholic Church will call their saints. And this young little girl was in some little class, and the teacher says, does anyone know who a saint is or what a saint is? And all the kids looked at each other and they had no idea how to answer that question. But she quickly raised her hand. She said, they are the ones that the sun shines through. She had been looking up at different pictures of people who had lived selflessly and Christ had shone through them. I just think of a story of Mother Teresa, you know, in Calcutta. And she was there caring for a leper, washing the wounds of a leper, probably of someone she had never even possibly met before and didn't even know. But some tourists came by and they had their cameras with them and they looked down at her and she heard one of them whisper something to the other one as they were taking pictures. And one of the tourists just said, I wouldn't do that for $1 million. And Mother Teresa looked up at them as she was washing this person's wounds and said, I wouldn't either. Neither would I. See, she was doing it, I believe, to please her Heavenly Father. And she understood that when she did it unto Christ, whenever she was doing it to whoever, it doesn't matter, the least of these, she was actually doing it to Christ. And so she was living, I believe, in the presence of God, that she was desiring constantly to please him. I believe the saddest condition in the world is when our hearts become so cold that we don't even ache for his presence anymore. You know, our conscience can be seared. Our heart can be so separated from him. But David prayed this, do not cast me from your presence. He could have prayed anything. After his sin with Bathsheba, his prayer was, God, please, no matter what you do, please, I'm begging of you, don't take your presence or your Holy Spirit from me. Don't do that. He says, restore unto me what? The joy of your salvation. What was he asking for? For God's presence to remain with him. He says, in your presence is the fullness of joy. So when he was asking him, he says, don't take your presence from me. He's saying, listen, you know, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. He was saying, where's your presence? Please don't take it from me. Please give your precious presence back to me so that I can experience the overwhelming joy of living in your presence. So if you remember Cain, once he killed Abel, it says his punishment is he was thrust out of the presence of God. And this sinful man who was a murderer, he said to God, he says, this is too much for me to bear. It's too much for me to bear. You can think of the greatest horrific cry in human history, bar none, is this. It's when Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Two that had never been forsaken, ever, had always been with one another in perfect unity. Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit, perfect union for all eternity up to that point. And the Holy Spirit is being ripped from him. The Father is turning his back on him. He says, God, my God, my God, why have you forsaken me? You know why? The Father turned his face on his Son so that he could turn it towards you, so that you never had to, for a moment from this point on, to be out of his presence by any willful known sin in your life. That's the grace of God, that when Jesus laid his life down, that veil was torn, and that the presence of God came exploding out of the Holy of Holies, and that we can go in, and that we can be one with him, and that we can live a life of total union with God. You know, another person had the presence of God leave them, but this person was completely oblivious. Samson was a man who just had the grace of God on him in such amazing ways. It says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him. And he did these massive feats of strength when the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. But he kept playing with sin and playing with sin and playing with sin. And he finally fell asleep with his head in Delilah's lap, and his seven locks were cut off. Just perfect submission. And the locks come off. It's the last symbol of his set apartness unto God. And he thought he was going to get up and throw some more Philistines out some windows. But it says this, and it may be the most terrifying passage of scripture in the whole Bible. It says he did not know that the Spirit of the Lord had left him. He was powerless. He was powerless. Let me tell you something. He not only was powerless, he was clueless. He didn't realize what had happened. He had all the self-confidence in the world, but zero self-awareness that the Spirit of God was not with him to do these great feats that God had enabled him up to that point. Do you sense power in your life? It comes from the presence of God. That's where it comes from. You know, during the Exodus, God gave his people at Mount Sinai not only his word, but he also gave them something to direct them, to protect them, to guide them, to lead them. And that was his tangible presence. I challenge you, get in his word every single day. Feast your mind, meditate on it. But don't just do that. Say, God, I'm coming to your word so I can come to you. Jesus said, these people, they search the scriptures because they think they're going to find life in them. But that is what leads you to me. I challenge you, don't stop with the written word. Go to the living word and experience his tangible presence moment by moment, and the power that comes as you seek him and seek his precious presence every moment of the day. May God bless you.